Hello, and welcome to the History Uncensored podcast. My name, as always, is Seth Michaels. I'm here to bring you history the way that it should be taught. Well, probably not in school because I tend to swear, but history as it should be taught as far as what we're learning. Today, I might lose some of you. That's okay. I can live with that. I'm not here to necessarily make friends or anything. I want to share the facts. I want to share the history and what it means to us. Kind of hype this episode up a little bit. And I'm sorry about last week. I was gone. I was at Gen Con. If you ever get the chance to go, I recommend it. If you like a bunch of, you know, tens of thousands of sweaty people jammed into a large room playing board games, then it's probably for you. Regardless, we're here for the history. And today's episode is called Remembering Reagan. I didn't tell you what this episode is about. It is technically the third Histories Idiots episode, but it's the second in the series after Christopher Columbus. Christopher Columbus's episode was great. A lot of really good information out there on him, so go back and listen to it. But today, we're going to do Ronald Reagan. And he was recommended, a friend of mine, undisclosed, said, "Hey, you know, I really think that you should do Ronald Reagan." I said, "Why?" I said, "I don't understand. It doesn't seem like something that I would normally be interested in covering." And, you know, and I knew a little bit about his history and kind of what he did, but I didn't know all of it. Well, the way I do my research, and because I have ADD and such, I basically went down a rabbit hole of information regarding Ronald Reagan. I don't think I'll ever get back any of that time, but the rabbit hole is deep. This is going to be the first episode in several for Remembering Reagan, History's Idiots. I don't know what to tell you other than that. I guess you'll just have to wait and find out and hear what I have to say. You can turn it off now if you're a fan of Reagan. What I will say is pretty damning. So, you know, you do you, and I'll do me. And if you really want to make this into politics, I don't. I'm just doing this based on a recommendation, and I do it my way. If you want to recommend a historical figure to me, hit me up, man. Regardless, don't say it's about History's Idiots. You know, I can do a podcast on something else. But if anybody wants to suggest a topic, all you have to do is hit me up on Twitter, Seth4Nerds, Seth the number 4 Nerds. You can email me at contact@historyuncensoredpod.com. Leave a comment on my website. An infinite number of ways to get a hold of me, really. And I will always respond. So if you don't like it, let's change it. You know, let's change the future. We can't change the past. I haven't done such a recent figure in history. After doing the research, I am pretty firmly in the belief that some of the mistakes that he made during his time as president of the United States really sent us into a spiral. It pushed us toward one of the most unequal periods of life in the United States, and this continuing period of inequality between the rich and the poor and the white and non-white, however you want to look at it. I don't believe in race. We're all Homo sapiens, or Homo sapiens sapiens, the wise man. I don't believe in it. Perhaps one day I will explain to you exactly why race is just bullshit and completely fucking made up. Today's not that day, because though in my mind there's no difference between me and somebody else, that doesn't mean that they haven't been treated improperly or wrongly in the past. I go over to my slavery podcast. I'm going to go over it here. It's some heavy stuff. This one's pretty analytical heavy. So bear with me as I get through it. When we look back at Ronald Reagan, he's often looked at as a good president. His economics plans seem to have worked, and he really took the war to drugs. He told Gorbachev to tear down that wall and, many other Reaganisms over the course of his presidency. There are certain aspects that some or most don't like to remember about his time in the White House. We don't like to remember the war on race as much on drugs or ethnics. We don't like to remember what happened to the deregulation of financial institutions, which led to the collapse of the economy 2 times. We don't like to remember the arms deals with Iran and other Middle Eastern countries and war leaders. We don't like to remember the money sent to fund Central American guerrilla warfare and drug cartels. But this isn't a podcast about remembering the good things. This is a podcast about remembering what's really going on, what really happened. So let us do that. Today, we're mostly going to focus on his war on drugs. That's what's going to happen. We're mostly going to focus on his war on drugs. But before we do that, I really want to kind of take a look at who Ronald Reagan was. He's a small town guy, born to poor parents in Illinois. He'd eventually become a screen actor, film actor, a motivational speaker, and then kind of gained political fame for his Time for Choosing speech in 1964. During Goldman running for election. I'm going to have that audio available to listen to on the website. If nothing else, it provides a look at both his personal motivations, kind of can be looked as his beginning of his corruption in government. His opinions shared in that speech changed fairly drastically by the time that he reached the Oval Office. And I don't blame him for trying to reach the White House. I don't want to be seen as a miser of history and a distorter of facts. So before I go any further along this path, I want to reiterate a few things. This is a podcast about real history. I cannot say fact because most of history is observation and personal reflection. But this history, the stuff I'm going to share with you today and in the following episodes, are indeed facts. You can hate me. I'm not here to be liked. You can try and discredit me. Good luck. I have no credit anywhere except maybe with my wife and children. You can check my sources. You can check them again and again and again. But do not blame me for sharing important truths to the public. Do not blame me for your closed mind. Look instead to your neighbors, your friends, your colleagues, and all those whom you love and cherish and relish in all the opportunity we as humanity have in sharing unique ideas that can expand our mindset. Being stuck in the left or the right has gotten us into this mess. We need to find a way out. So I want to start with the truth. Not as I see it, but as history should, and with a speculative eye for detail, how history does see it. Before 1962, Reagan was a registered Democrat. He even divorced his first wife, I think it was like 1949, because they had political, disputes. She was a Republican. He was a Democrat. They didn't like each other, even after adopting a child and having another one. But yeah, they divorced because they were too politically indifferent. 1962, he shared his speech. 64, he shared a speech. Like I said, go and listen to that. And in 1967, he became the governor of California. Man, this is the start of the troubles. 1967, I think it was through about 76, he got into trouble pretty frequently for trying to solve problems basically with violence, including an incident which is remembered as Bloody Thursday, where 111 police officers were injured and one student, University of California Berkeley student, was killed. This only happened after Reagan sent in police officers during a peaceful protest, originally to discuss the Arab-Israeli conflict at the time. After that, after Bloody Thursday, he sent in a couple thousand army reserves, of which he previously was in the army. He didn't see any active duty because he was he had poor eyesight. No fault to him. He probably tried. I think he was a second lieutenant. So he did his duty. I can't tell you how much I appreciate anybody that does. But following that conflict, that peaceful, should have been peaceful, you know, peacefully resolved conflict, this is what he says. And I quote, "If it takes a bloodbath, let's get it over with. No more appeasement." And this is his governor of California. Reagan's terms as governor helped to shape the policies he would pursue in his later political career as president. By campaigning on a platform of sending the welfare bums back to work, also quoted, he spoke out against the idea of the welfare state. He also strongly advocated the Republican idea of less government regulation of the economy, including that of undue federal taxation, which we'll get into significantly more in the Reaganomics episode. Let's just say when you don't tax people much and you increase spending in military funding, you're the debt to the economy, to the debt to other nations is going to go up. Sorry, man. That's just how it works. Oh, enough of that. Like I said, I'm going to get into that another episode, and we'll do a really deep dive into that. Hopefully I'll have somebody on the podcast, an economist, to come in and help explain it. Because as good as I am at history, I'm less talented at explaining economics, especially macroeconomics. First on the list, though, he failed to run for president of the United States after he was done with governor of California, 1976. He didn't make it out of the GOP primary, lost to Gerald Ford, who in turn lost to Jimmy Carter, and eventually we'll see Reagan in the office following Carter's presidency. Get into now the first part here, and that's going to be the war on drugs. Holy shit, this was a problem. All right, guys, first we're going to give you a little background on the war on drugs, and then we're going to give you the goods. 1971, President Nixon declared the war on drugs, and in 1981, Ronald Reagan did the same thing. After initially embraced greater investment in treatment, rehabilitation, and public health to combat substance abuse, 2 years later, you know, after 1971, Republican Governor Nelson Rockefeller of New York, who had authorized the assault on Attica, was trying to reposition himself politically. As he wanted to run for the White House, led the state in enacting some of the nation's toughest drug laws. These laws mandated steep minimum sentences for the sale and use of controlled substances, notably heroin and cocaine. New York's drug laws also influenced other states that sought to enact tough, lengthy sentences for drug offenses. The Reagan administration dramatically escalated the war that Nixon had started in 1971. The war on drugs, even though drug use had been falling for most illicit substances since 1979, President Reagan launched his own version of the war on drugs and renewed the call to arms again 4 years later. Public opinion surveys in 86 indicated that fewer than 2% of the American public considered illegal drugs to be the most important problem facing the country. Surveys conducted 2 years later, however, showed that a majority of the public now identified drug abuse as a leading problem. Yeah, let's do war on drugs. Yeah, let's solve it. Oh, wait, it's worse. It is so much worse. The shift in public opinion during that time was partly a consequence of the enactment of tough new federal drug laws in 86 and 88, spurred by the reports that crack cocaine had been introduced into urban drug markets through the media. And I should do a Histories Idiots episode on the media, but I don't have that much time on my hands. It would be literally, it could be a podcast all by itself. Hey, I would listen to that podcast. If anybody wants to go out there and do a podcast on the history of media and the fuck-ups they've made and the problems that they have caused, you don't even have to do worldwide. You can just do American problems. Just problems in the United States caused by the media, I would listen to the shit out of that. And if you need help doing research for it, man, I guess that's what I'm as good at as anything. All right, back to this. The new drug laws from 86 and 88 resulted in historically unprecedented rates of imprisonment for drug use and possession. People convicted of drug offenses grew to make up about one-fifth of all state prison inmates and nearly two-thirds of all federal inmates by 1997. Since the portion of state prisoners serving time for drug offenses stabilized at about the same rate, while the portion of federal inmates serving time for drug offenses declined to about one-half since then. In the 1980s, Democratic politicians notably joined the war on drugs. It wasn't just Republicans. The two parties embarked on periodic bidding wars to ratchet up penalties for drugs and other offenses. This is also a really big crime. Most of the reason for this ratcheting up of this war on drugs was because in places that politicians were ratcheting up the pressure on the war on drugs were the places that those politicians were getting elected. And instead of seeking to better their constituents' lives, they were seeking re-election. Once you hold power, you don't want to give it up, I guess, something to that nature, but no longer caring as much about the public and how those arrests might affect the families and the communities was a huge problem. And doing it just for re-election, I mean, it's the same problem we're running into now, right? Where you have politicians running for re-election just to stay doing the job and not necessarily to do it properly. And that's on both sides, regardless. I'm going to go over some crime rates between 1980 and 1989. Man, for somebody that was supposedly hard on drugs, the consequences of it were pretty staggering. Particularly for one group, that's going to be blacks, African-Americans, whatever you want to say, is tough. Between 83 and 89, black arrests for murders went up. Arrests for murder went up for only one ethnic group in the United States. And during that time, it decreased for all other entities. The same can be said for robbery. The only increase for arrests, imprisonment, came in the black community. Between 83 and 89 again, aggravated assault rate raised 50% for the black community, while all other entities rose approximately 5%. And this wasn't the rate that the crimes were being committed, because for that, it was pretty consistent across the board. I mean, more crime was being committed in general, but the amount of people that were being arrested rose specifically for the black community and blacks significantly more than anybody else. And I'm going to give you more data to support this fact. It's not opinion. I'm going to give you more data to support this, and you can read more about this on my website, and I'll have my sources posted there as well. Simple assault rates over the same period rose 100%. So aggravated assault, 50. Simple assault rates rose 100% for blacks. Larceny theft rates increased again only for one part of the population between 83 and 89. I bet you guys can guess who I'm talking about. The same can be said about motor vehicle theft, which again increased by 100% or thereabouts during Reagan's time in the White House. Here's what the war on drugs yielded for the Reagan administration. Instead of fighting the problem that should be fought, drug use increased for both black and whites during his administration. The problem is that in 1980, almost all ethnic groups shared a similar drug use profile and arrest rates were similar. By 1989, up from 300 arrests per 100,000, the black community was being arrested at nearly 1,200 arrests per 100,000. 400% increase. 400%. Whites, granted, they saw their increase go up 100%. You know, they went from 300 arrests to 600. Well, blacks went from about 300 arrests to 1,200 arrests per 100,000. The war on drugs was prohibitively expensive, and I'll get more into the costs, the direct costs to society, probably in the Reaganomics episode. I'll also discuss how much it cost our prison system, how much it cost us as the population to enact these laws, so on and so forth. It's pretty significant. But overall, arrest rates for blacks in the United States, 1980 was 9.45%. For whites, it was 3.97%. So already, you know, it wasn't just all Reagan. But 9.45% in 1980. Whites, it was 3.97% in 1980. By 1989, the arrest rate for blacks in the United States was 14.8%, where the arrest rate for whites was increased to 4.74%. Now, if we're fighting a war on drugs and crime, shouldn't we be trying to stop the crimes from happening instead of arresting more people? Because it obviously didn't work. And you have these numbers, you know, within a couple of years of enacting these laws and not doing anything about it is gross incompetence. It's incredibly frustrating to look back at these numbers and see the way that the United States was living in the 80s. By the end of his term, almost 14% of the black population was arrested. Holy fuck. Over 14%, where the total population of the United States was arrested, I mean, almost 6%, 5.82 by the time that his term was ended. So you went from 4.6 for the total population in 1980 to 5.82. I mean, basically an increase of 1.2%, which is significant. That's not a small increase. That's huge. About 4 million more people were arrested in 1989 than in 1980. And this wasn't stopping people from doing drugs or committing crime. It wasn't. The crimes were happening more frequently. Part of that might have been the wage inequality gap heightening during this time, where more of the wealth was seen at the top than the bottom. When you see that happening, you see an increase in violent crime. You see an increase in drug use. And the dependence on other substances to get through life, because the other parts of what you have going on are generally terrible. And that's really what this war on drugs did. It wasn't directly a war on drugs. It was a war on the poor. It was the war on blacks. And it was really a war on black poor people. It might be hypothesized that blacks were arrested at higher rates for drug crimes because they used drugs at higher rates. But the best available evidence refutes that hypothesis. A long historical trend dating back to the 1970s is available from the monitoring the Future Survey of High School Seniors. Self-reported drug use among blacks is consistently lower than among whites, a pattern replicated among adults in the National Survey on Drug Abuse. What I'm saying is white people use drugs more frequently than black people, year after year after year. And yet, during Reagan's time, during his administration, you saw blacks being arrested at significantly higher rates. You saw them being imprisoned in significantly higher rates. And though our taxes were cut, our tax money, instead of going to things like education and rehabilitation and proper programs that work, were being put towards keeping these men behind bars, which for a drug offense, which in my opinion it is offensive all on its own, but like it went to keeping them behind bars and feeding them instead of them getting a job and boosting the economy. We didn't allow that to happen. They can't get jobs going to jail. And once you get out of jail, the chance of you getting a job is even lower. So you're hurting the economy threefold by this war on drugs. You're paying for the war on drugs. You're paying for the imprisonment. And then you're paying afterward because the population that's hurt the most is poor black males. And man, they couldn't, you know, feed their family, and it's just bullshit. It's just all bullshit. I was not expecting to find this information when I went searching for it. But I mean, I'm just going to continue. It doesn't stop here. So right now I'm looking at a graph of admission rates and imprisonment rates among the black and white communities. I mean, it's literally off the chart. I don't know what to say. It's off the chart. I'm about to get into something I believe everybody should read if you're listening to this podcast. It will be available on my website. The Growth of Incarceration in the United States, Exploring Causes and Consequences. Now, I say everybody should read it. That's only if you're willing to read it. I mean, we're talking about a publication that was some like 450 pages long, but you know, if you're into that, if you want to really know where the source material for what I'm talking about is coming from, it was invaluable to me in analyzing the historical data. Most of the following passages come directly from that paper. It was an unbiased look done by over 20 scientists, economists. I think it was done in 2014. Basically, it was about 20 different people going through and gathering the data and doing this research and putting it together for government publication. Here's the raw data for incarceration rates in the United States. This is just on a table. In 1980, there were about 329,000 people imprisoned in the United States. In 1989, there were 710,000 people imprisoned in the United States. Population wasn't going up by 2-to-1, you know, by a 1-to-1 ratio. You know, we weren't increasing the population by 2-to-1. We weren't increasing the amount of drug users in a, you know, in a 1-to-1 ratio over that time. We weren't, but yet the amount of people that we were incarcerating during the Reagan administration significantly increased, more than two times the amount of people that were incarcerated in 1980, you know, were incarcerated by 1989, 115%, 0.3, if you want to be exact. To give you an idea, in between 72 and 80, about the same length of time, the state prison and jail populations grew about 60%. So 50% less. In the 80s, the incarcerated population more than doubled its size across all three levels, local, state, and federal. By 1990, the incarcerated population increased to more than four times its 1972 level. By 2000, state prison and jail populations were about six times higher than in 72. In the 2000s, it did start slowing significantly. I mean, federal prison rates grew significantly faster than state and local jail in the 80s and 90s, and even in the 2000s when penal populations in state and local institutions had almost ceased to grow. The population of the federal system increased in size by more than 40% between 2001 and 2010. What I really want to do is I want to look at what changes in U.S. society and public policy drove the rise in incarceration. I want to look at what consequences, you know, these changes had, and what effects the incarceration has on those in confinement, on their families, their children, their neighborhoods, and the communities from which they come and from which they have to return to. And I want to look at the economy, the politics, the structure, and the culture of the U.S. society. What are the implications for public policy of the evidence on causes and effects of high levels of incarceration? What I mean is, what does public policy do when we jail more people, what are their fact, what are the effects on the population as a total, for those causes? I want to look at why it's important for today's society, why we have to look at it now and see the reason why we're here. In the 60s and 70s, you saw an unprecedented rate of, inclusion in civil rights for the black community, for blacks. You saw an unprecedented rise in it. You saw their wages start becoming more fair and still not fair. You saw for equally qualified individuals, same thing for women. You saw that rise, and then you see a sharp drop off in the 1980s. You saw they might not have been being as persecuted on the streets as much. I'm not talking about by police officers, but by their community, by others of different ethnic origin than themselves. They might not have been pursued as much that way, but in the 1980s, this war on black society by the Reagan administration is complete, and you can't deny it when you look at the information, when you look at the stats. With nearly one of every 100 adults in prison or jail, and remember during the 80s, it was even higher than that. Those who are incarcerated in the U.S. prisons come largely from the most disadvantaged segments of the population. They comprise mainly minority men under the age of 40. They're poorly educated, and they often carry additional deficits of drug and alcohol addiction, mental and physical illness, and a lack of work preparation or experience. Their criminal responsibility is real, but it is embedded in a context of social and economic disadvantage. More than half of the prison population is black or Hispanic. During the 1980s, the U.S. Congress and most state legislators enacted laws mandating lengthy prison sentences, often 5, 10, and 20 years or longer for drug offenses, violent offenses, and career criminals. These changes in sentencing reflected a consensus that viewed incarceration as the key instrument for crime control. It's not. Yet, over the four decades when incarceration rates steadily rose, U.S. crime rates showed no clear trend. The rate of violent crime rose, and then fell, then rose again, then declined sharply at the end when we stopped incarcerating a bunch of people. The best signal, proximate explanation of the rise in incarceration is not rising crime rates, because the amount of people committing crimes didn't change, but the policy choices made by the legislators to greatly increase the use of imprisonment as a response to crime. Mandatory prison sentences, intensified enforcement of drug laws, and long sentences contributed not only to overall high rates of incarceration, but also especially to extraordinary rates of incarceration in Black and Latino communities. What I'm saying is the unprecedented rise in jailing can be attributed to increasingly punitive political climate surrounding criminal justice policy. I mean, that really provided the context for a series of policy choices across all branches and levels of government that significantly increased sentence lengths, required prison time for minor offenses, and intensified punishment for drug crimes. All right, that was a lot of information to go over. Don't worry, there's a shit ton more where that came from. I want to talk about what the fuck was happening during this time. Why were blacks being imprisoned more than whites, other than racism, other than literally choosing black communities and black peoples out more than white when doing, let's say you're pulling somebody over, or when you meet them on the street. And the legal system in the United States isn't perfect, right? And if the cops think they have probable cause, they can go in and they can look, and they see probable cause much more frequently in blacks than in white. It just happens. Again, not that blacks are committing the crime more frequently than whites, because that's not proven, right? That's not proven at all, whether it's violent crime or nonviolent crime. It's just blacks are arrested more frequently for it. There's been a bunch of research on the crime effects of incarceration attempts to measure reductions in crime that might result from deterrence and incapacitation. Long sentences characterize the period of high incarceration rates, but research on deterrence suggests that would-be offenders are deterred more by the risk of being caught than by the severity of the penalty that they would face if arrested and convicted. High rates of incarceration may have reduced crime rates through incapacitation, locking up people who might otherwise commit crimes, but there's no strong consensus on the magnitude of this effect, and because offending declines markedly with age, the incapacitation effect of very long sentences is likely to be pretty small. What that's saying is that the younger you are, the more likely you are to commit a crime, the more likely you are to be put in jail, which is equally terrible because that is the period in life where you can change your future, you can set yourself up for success. And when you're taking people off the street and you're taking people out of the economy, you're not just taking them out of the economy for now, you're taking them out of the economy for later when they return to society. It's a very low success rate on people coming out of lengthy jail sentences and succeeding economically in the outside world, especially because they were disadvantaged most of the time to begin with. They didn't have the education that, let's say, that I had. They didn't have that opportunity. They just didn't. You know, among white male high school dropouts born in the late 70s, about one-third are estimated to have served time in prison by their 30s. And yet incarceration rates have reached even higher levels among young black men with little schooling. Among black male high school dropouts, about two-thirds have a prison record by their mid-30s. Two-thirds of high school dropouts from black males have a prison record by the time they're in their mid-30s. Again, they are not committing crimes any more frequently than white people, especially drug crimes. White people do more drugs. They do. Much of the significance of the social and economic consequence of incarceration is rooted in the high absolute level of incarceration for minority groups and in the large racial disparities in incarceration rates. In the era of high incarceration rates, really beginning in the 1980s, during Reagan's administration, prison admission and return have become commonplace in minority neighborhoods characterized by high levels of crime, poverty, family instability, poor health, and residential segregation. Racial disparities in incarceration have tended to differentiate the life chances and civic participation of blacks, in particular, from those of most other Americans. High rates of incarceration are associated with lower levels of civic and political engagement among former prisoners and their families and friends than among others in their communities. Disfranchisement of former prisoners and the way prisoners are enumerated in the U.S. Census combined to weaken the power of low-income and minority communities. For these people, the quality of citizenship, the quality of their membership in American society, and their relationship to public institutions has been impaired. These developments have created a highly distinct political and legal universe for a very large section of the United States population. Alternatively, prison can be harmful, degrading, and exposing the confined to criminal influence, basically putting those that have, let's say, a drug use charge on their record in prison and confining them in an area with other criminals. We think that's a good idea, where criminal influence to violence and humiliation, isolating them from nurturing human contact and personal responsibility at a time when their brains aren't even fully developed in their late teens and early 20s. We think that's a good idea. And then leaving them poorly equipped for life on the outside, not giving them an opportunity to learn properly when they are being jailed on how to succeed in life outside. We're just saying, hey, here, go to jail. Don't learn anything except maybe how to be a better criminal. And we'll see you again in a few years. Now, that's not for everybody. There are circumstances that point to, you know, there are always success stories. But success rates are low. We can't even take the time to help these people prepare for a life outside of prison. Some of them just had committed minor drug charges, being caught with crack cocaine, which crack cocaine was being done by the black community, and white powdered cocaine was done being by, well, white people. And because crack cocaine, which is a little bit different, you smoke it, you know, was done more by black people than white people, it was more heavily, we'll just say this, police and policy went after crack cocaine significantly harder than powdered cocaine. The incarceration rate, the arrest rate for it, and the length of time that you were incarcerated or jailed significantly increased between the two. Well, crack cocaine was cheaper. And as I discussed, the poor black people were using it. You had, and it was brought to a media frenzy by, you know, an NFL player being killed by it, and then an NBA player being killed by it. And these were young people. They were promising, and they were killed by this drug, and so the media went after it. So what happens after the media goes after it? Policy goes after it. And then not only do you have policy going after the drug, you're going after the users. And by ignoring powdered cocaine, which had a significant influence on American society in the 80s, not just because you weren't jailed as much, you know, it was being used liberally on Wall Street and in other parts of high society. All of this was going on. It was all happening. It's just really, really depressing. All right, we're going to take a small break. I'm going to come back and we'll continue this talk. Finish up the war on drugs and go over a couple more things. I want to talk about deterrence, like what the policies were. You know, it just kind of, well, not kind of, the war on drugs didn't really make sense. Drug rates, for the most part, the majority were falling since, for a long time, since basically the 70s. And Ronald Reagan's renewed emphasis on the war on drugs, I think, was just a mistake. There was no reason for it. The Just Say No campaign was an absolute failure, and I'll talk about that later. First of all, especially the policies that were enacted, really imprisoning more people, that just doesn't work. The empirical findings, you know, on the studies of deterrence have focused primarily on sentence enhancements that introduce additional prison time, which is what the policies did. Basically, what they found was that through increased prison time, it doesn't decrease your chance of committing further crime beyond the fact that you're getting older, which I already discussed is a crime prevention in itself. As you get older, as your frontal cortex fully develops and you begin to realize that there are consequences for your actions, your chance of committing crimes decreases. So if you're in prison for 10 years and you get out, your chance of committing crimes don't decrease because you were in prison for 10 years, they decrease because you're 10 years older. Also, by the time that you've gotten out of prison, you're more than likely to have a mental health issue. It's been pretty extensively documented that in the United States, upwards more than 50% of people imprisoned have mental health issues. And if you are a female going into prison, you are have a significantly higher chance of leaving prison with a mental health issue than when you got there. So maybe that's deterrent enough. Don't go to prison. You'll leave with a mental health issue. Not always, just sometimes. As I discussed earlier, in 1989, 27% of the American public felt that drugs or drug abuse was the most important problem facing the country. Well, 4 years ago, in 1985, only 2% gave that response. Reagan stressed the importance of criminal justice agencies and the federal government's efforts to combat drug abuse. In 1986, Reagan informed the nation of the federal government's progress in combating drug abuse. He said, "From the beginning of our administration, we've taken strong steps to do something about this horror. Tonight, I can report to you that we've made much progress. 37 federal agencies are working together in a vigorous national effort, and by next year, our spending for drug law enforcement will have more than tripled from its 1981 levels. We have increased seizures of illegal drugs. Shortages of marijuana are now being reported. Last year alone, over 10,000 drug criminals were convicted, and nearly 250 million of their assets were seized by the DEA, the Drug Enforcement Administration." He's right, yeah. The number of federal drug convictions rose pretty sharply between 80 and 86. The total number of individuals convicted of federal drug offenses more than doubled. A lot. Yeah, sure. On the outside, it might have seemed like it was working, but people weren't doing drugs less. They were just being arrested more frequently for doing the same amount of drugs. And because drug users were being imprisoned, there were fewer drug users in the United States. But for some reason, as drug rates decreased, arrests increased for drugs. I can't get my head around that one. Here are some of the laws that were enacted. The Comprehensive Crime Control Act of 1984 passed crime legislation that, among other things, enhanced penalties for drug violations and established general criminal forfeiture provisions for certain felony drug violations. These provisions allow the Attorney General to transfer drug-related property to federal, state, and local law enforcement agencies and retain forfeited property for official use or for transfer to other federal, state, and local agencies related to federal law enforcement. It also allowed the Attorney General to place an uncontrolled substance under temporary control that triggers the regulatory requirements of registration and record keeping, as well as authorize criminal penalties in order to avoid imminent hazard to public safety. That's a lot to unpack. The most important thing here is they allow forfeitures. So when you are in prison, when you are taken to prison, when you are arrested, they can literally take your property. Literally take your property. And they did. They took a lot of property. Reagan himself said, "Hey man, we've gained $250 million worth of property assets from these criminals." The crappiest thing about this is these criminals operate in the lower percentages of humanity. They operate in the, you know, the bottom of the barrel. So you're not taking property from the wealthy. You're taking property from the poor who already have or destitute of property. You're taking property from the blacks who have found it since the very beginning much harder to appropriate property. That's incredible. So you're not only are you arresting more people, well, now your law enforcement to get better funding to do it, they have to go and arrest more people and seize more property, and then their funding increases, their weaponization increases. Damn, that's kind of fucked up, huh? When you think about that, I guess there's nothing else to really say. That was huge in implementation in minority societies, because inner cities still to this day remain very segregated. And it's much easier to, in these poorer cultures, these poorer communities, to infiltrate and become a, it's much easier to be undercover in those communities, which are much less tight-knit than wealthier, even middle-class communities. Because generally, the rule is black people go to black people for drugs. White people go to white people to get their drugs. It's generally not done in homes, and in if you are in a middle-class society, it's generally not done anywhere near the public. It's significantly harder to ingratiate yourself into that community and into those people and arrest them for drugs than it is to ingratiate yourself into a constantly changing environment of minorities and the destitute. It's just easier. So it's easier to gain federal funding because you're arresting more people and gaining more property and more assets. That's just it, man. That's it. That's where it comes from. It's the, again, 1984, the Comprehensive Crime Control Act, basically ball sacks. So that's one of them. The Anti-Drug Abuse Acts of 1986, 1988, the Anti-Drug Abuse Act of 86 was a significant development in pursuing enforcement action against the illicit synthetic drug trade. Among other things, it amended the CSA to allow for controlled substance analogs. Through the Anti-Drug Abuse it differentiated cocaine from powder cocaine and crack cocaine and required 100 times more powder cocaine than crack cocaine to trigger the more severe minimum sentence. 500 grams versus 5. Though later Congress in 2010 reduced the disparity from 100 to 1 to 18 to 1. Good work, I guess. This next part, really I just want to say that in incarcerating people, as I mentioned, it really doesn't work. There's no evidence saying, hey, yeah, this is actually going to reduce crime. It's just going to increase the burden on the American public. Here are some numbers and just some final annotations that I'm going to kind of go over today. This comes from Kenneth B. Nunn from racism.org. By almost any measure, the drug war's impact on African American communities has been devastating. Millions of African Americans have been imprisoned. Many have been unfairly treated by the criminal justice system. The rights of both legitimate suspects and average citizens have been violated. The quality of life of many millions more has been adversely affected. These effects are the consequences of deliberate decisions. First, to fight a war on drugs, and second, to fight that war against low-level street dealers in communities populated by people of color. Over the past four decades, federal and state governments have poured over $1 trillion into the war on drugs, and they have relied on taxpayers to foot the bill. Unfortunately, these tax dollars haven't solved the problems they were intended to solve. There's literally no evidence that the war on drugs has done anything but imprison more people. In 1980, 50,000 people behind bars for drug law violations. We're coming on 2020 here, 2019. We have about 500,000. More than 1 million people are arrested simply for drug possession in the U.S. every year. That's about one every 25 seconds. Money funneled into drug enforcement has meant less funding to improve public safety and has left essential education, health, social service, and public safety programs struggling to operate on meager funding. Drug war advocates continue to demand more money for the same policies, despite the fact that highly funded law enforcement and interdiction strategies have failed to reduce drug use and drug availability. The demand for drugs in the United States has remained constant, despite the United States' enormous financial commitment to fighting the war on drugs. The drug war has created enormous public health costs by limiting the availability of harm reduction programs that could quell overdose and infectious disease transmission rates. Just as disheartening as the fiscal costs of fighting a failed drug war are the opportunities. Think of all the impact that the drug war funding could have had instead of financing the arrest and incarceration of people each year. We made drug treatment more widely available. If we could give anonymous access to people to test the drugs for unknown substances, or let's say like fentanyl-laced heroin, which causes a significant amount of deaths in the U.S., I mean, we have the funding schemes, which I just mentioned, because funding for law enforcement is often based on the number of arrests and the property seized. The easiest way for local police to up the numbers and boost their careers is to target low-level drug offenders. Asset forfeiture laws. These laws allow law enforcement agencies to keep the property they seized during drug arrests with minimal proof, putting the burden instead on suspects to prove their own innocence. As a result, local law enforcement agencies tend to increase their focus on drug arrests, often at the expense of more pressing public safety needs. I want to take a moment and talk about the Just Say No campaign, and then I want to finish up with I want to finish up with kind of the sociologic impact that the war on drugs has had. So first of all, Nancy Reagan took some of the onus off of her husband by starting her campaign Just Say No. For there to be an enemy, you need to create an enemy, right? To fight the war on drugs, there needs to be an enemy. And, well, the enemy is the drug user. And that's partially what the war on drugs did and why it helped push us into what's going on today and the racism problems and the institutional backlash against the black community for crimes that, although they're committing, aren't committing at a higher rate than anybody else. What Just Say No is doing, it's putting a target on drug dealers. It's dehumanizing them and drug users. It's stigmatizing them. It's saying, hey, these other people are bad and they deserve to be locked up and they deserve to be punished. And I'm not saying that if you're doing drugs, you shouldn't be punished. Although I do strongly believe in open drug policies. But the Just Say No and the DARE program, which is something that I went through as a kid, to me, it, among other things, it taught you about drugs and that there were drugs. And let's say you do live in a poor society or a poor community, and you have this option that says, hey, you know, if I take these drugs, perhaps if I drink or I smoke or I do cocaine or I do heroin or whatever the case is, that there's another option for me. And these drugs cost money. Well, how do you, it's just an issue all around. You're introducing the idea of selling drugs. You're introducing the idea of drugs to people that might not have, you know, known about it. I do think that it should be talked about and it should be educated, but it should be done in a completely different way that doesn't put enormous pressure on the individual to just say no. My wife, God bless her soul, has trouble saying no to her parents when they ask about going over to dinner. I have problems saying no when somebody asks me for help. And that's a stranger. Imagine if your friends, and some of you have gone through this, right? Your friends say, hey, man, it's okay to do this. You know, what's the big deal? Just say no. Well, peer pressure. It's continued. Have you ever just said no to your friends? How many of them listen to you all the time? Hey, man, it's okay. Let's do this. Peer pressure isn't right, but it happens. And the thought or the idea of losing friends over something as simple as maybe like, taking some drugs is a terrifying thought for any individual, especially if it's somebody that you're close to. The Just Say No campaign didn't really hit on really the complex societal problems that would cause for anybody attempting it. I'm not going to say anything negative about Nancy Reagan here and perhaps her own personal war on prescription drugs. Just know that not everybody is always who they seem. And I mean, I strongly believe in giving everybody a chance. Now I want to talk about the impact it had on society in a different way. You're increasing the amount of people arrested by 5%. So already black people were being arrested at about 9% clip, right? 14% by 1990 were being arrested. And let's say that, and these numbers are pretty close here, that you have 25% of the time that somebody's arrested in the United States, they are later diagnosed with some form of mental illness. The longer you stay in prison, the higher chances of you developing a mental illness increase, which really, and ooh, this is really tough for me to, because I have a background in genetics and genetic anthropology, is when you're doing that, you are introducing trigger genes that were not necessarily activated or turned on previously. So when you're putting somebody in prison and you're putting them in that type of confinement and increasing their chance of mental illness, and then releasing them into the public with a mental illness and the public's inability to cope with the amount of people that do have it, you're increasing the amount of later generations that have mental illnesses. So you're going into prison, you might be fine. Well, by the time you leave prison, you might have developed anxiety, depression, a combination of both of them, schizoid tendencies caused by stress or fear or whatever the case is. If you didn't have one before, there's a possibility of you having one by the time that you leave. And that's unacceptable. You leave prison, you leave jail, you go back, you have children. Now, because that genetic marker has been activated in your, because we genetics are activated by our environment. I don't know if you guys knew that, but it's not just, hey, this is what you are from the day one. No, your environment helps change that. It helps mold you. And we might have the predisposition, the ability to have a mental illness, but it might not be triggered. But hey, you're in prison, all of these other things, your worry, your anxiety, your depression, boom, it's all triggered. Now the increase to your progeny have increased to get mental illness as well. Not only are you affecting the current generation of incarcerated individuals, you are affecting every generation that goes from that person's line all the way through the end of it. I guess that's not something that we think of very much, and how our actions, something as simple as, you know, let's say putting, and it's not simple, but as arresting and putting somebody in prison might affect not just them, but everybody. You're increasing the public health cost just over time. It's impossible for me to fathom the amount of money that the United States is going to have to spend on mental health issues just caused by incarcerated individuals since 1980. And because the government was disproportionately selecting Black communities and Black people for incarceration, you're disproportionately spreading mental health issues across those populations. You're increasing the public's cost to them. You're decreasing their quality of life. You're decreasing the quality of life of those individuals, of the future of those individuals. You're decreasing their life expectancy. We're literally killing these people faster. We're killing their children faster. I mean, fuck. What we have to sit back and learn from our mistakes. On my website, I'm going to have some more information basically about what we can do as a society. Like I said, I'm going to have all of my resources available for you to look through, some things that we can do to solve. If we spend less money on incarcerating individuals with drug problems and more money on public education, amongst other things, I think we can really do something, do good in this world. That is a lot on drugs and criminals, incarceration. I probably bored you to death. It's understandable, but as a modern society, we must understand where our weaknesses lie. Understanding and people willing to stand up and fight is what is necessary for change in America. For too long, the middle and lower classes have taken a backseat to the rich and wealthy. For too long, as the United States enacted prejudices against ethnic communities and values, the lasting damage Reagan's administration has done to this society is irreversible. He may have been likable. We may have appreciated some of the things that he had done while he was in office. It is unacceptable the current state of American political affairs and American racism unacceptable. I hope you guys all have a very wonderful day. I hope you go check out the website, historyuncensoredpod.com. If you have any questions or you want to yell at me, clap back at me on Twitter, clap back at me in my email, historyuncensored, or contact at historyuncensoredpod.com. I have a Facebook page out there now, Uncensored Podcasting Network. You can find me there, discussion group, if you want to talk about, you know, stuff that you might want covered in an upcoming series. Hit me up there. That's why it's there. It's the only reason I really go on Facebook anymore. Until next time, guys, be excellent to each other, and don't forget to go on to Apple or wherever you listen to the podcast, subscribe, and most importantly, subscribe and share it with your friends, but also rate and review me. I don't have that many reviews out there, so it's very unlikely that I'm going to be positioned in the algorithms of the interwebs to succeed as a podcaster. So if you like the show, it would be really amazing if you could help me out even just this one time. Go and review it, and like I said, most importantly, share it with your friends. And this episode is relevant to all members of society. We need to figure this shit out. That's what history is about. We're looking back to figure out the future, and where we were and where we can go. It should be two completely different things. Hope that you guys learned something. I hope you don't hate me. Actually, I don't give a fuck about that. I just hope you learned something, and I can't wait to share the next episode of Remembering Reagan, History's Idiots, and that'll be on Reaganomics and economic policy. It's going to be a good one. I think you'll really enjoy it. After that episode, we're going to do an episode on corruption and all of the deals that he made and his cabinet members, so on and so forth. And then there will be one more episode after that, but that's a secret. So enjoy your week and take care. As always, history remembers.
50 years ago, a great American in whose symbolic shadow we stand today signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This momentous decree came as a great beacon light of hope to millions of Negro slaves who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to end the long night of their captivity. But 100 years later, the Negro still is not free. 100 years later, the life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination. 100 years later, the Negro lives on a lonely island of poverty in the midst of a vast ocean of material prosperity. 100 years later, the Negro is still languished in the corners of American society and finds himself in exile in his own land. And so we've come here today to dramatize a shameful condition. In a sense, we've come to our nation's capital to cash a check. When the architects of our republic wrote the magnificent words of the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, they were signing a promissory note to which every American was to fall heir. This note was a promise that all men, yes, black men as well as white men, would be guaranteed the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. It is obvious today that America has defaulted on this promissory note insofar as her citizens of color are concerned. Instead of honoring this sacred obligation, America has given the Negro people a bad check, a check which has come back marked insufficient funds. But we refuse to believe that the Bank of Justice is bankrupt. We refuse to believe that there are insufficient funds in the great vaults of opportunity of this nation. And so we've come to cash this check, a check that will give us upon demand the riches of freedom and the security of justice. We have also come to this hallowed spot to remind America of the fierce urgency of now. This is no time to engage in the luxury of cooling off or to take the tranquilizing drug of gradualism. Now is the time to make real the promises of democracy. Now is the time to rise from the dark and desolate valley of segregation to the sunlit path of racial justice. Now is the time to lift our nation from the quicksands of racial injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood. Now is the time to make justice a reality for all of God's children. It would be fatal for the nation to overlook the urgency of the moment. This sweltering summer of the Negro's legitimate discontent will not pass until there is an invigorating autumn of freedom and equality. 1963 is not an end, but a beginning. Those who hope that the Negro needed to blow off steam and will now be content, we'll have a rude awakening if the nation returns to business as usual. There will be neither rest nor tranquility in America until the Negro is granted his citizenship rights. The whirlwinds of revolt will continue to shake the foundations of our nation until the bright day of justice emerges. But that is something that I must say to my people who stand on the warm threshold which leads into the palace of justice. In the process of gaining our rightful place, we must not be guilty of wrongful deeds. Let us not seek to satisfy our thirst for freedom by drinking from the cup of bitterness and hatred. We must forever conduct our struggle on the high plane of dignity and discipline. We must not allow our creative protest to degenerate into physical violence. Again and again, we must rise to the majestic heights of meeting physical force with soul force. The marvelous new militancy which has engulfed the Negro community must not lead us to a distrust of all white people. For many of our white brothers, as evidenced by their presence here today, have come to realize that their destiny is tied up with our destiny. And they have come to realize that their freedom is inextricably bound to our freedom. We cannot walk alone. And as we walk, we must make the pledge that we shall always march ahead. We cannot turn back. There are those who are asking the devotees of civil rights, when will you be satisfied? We can never be satisfied as long as the Negro is the victim of the unspeakable horrors of police brutality. We can never be satisfied. As long as our bodies, heavy with the fatigue of travel, cannot gain lodging in the motels of the highways and the hotels of the cities. We cannot be satisfied as long as the Negro's basic mobility is from a smaller ghetto to a larger one. We can never be satisfied as long as our children are stripped of their selfhood and robbed of their dignity by signs stating for whites only. We cannot be satisfied as long as a Negro in Mississippi cannot vote and a Negro in New York believes he has nothing for which to vote. No, we are not satisfied, and we will not be satisfied until justice rolls down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. I am not unmindful that some of you have come here out of great trials and tribulations. Some of you have come fresh from narrow jail cells. Some of you have come from areas where your quest for freedom left you battered by the storms of persecution and staggered by the winds of police brutality. You have been the veterans of creative suffering. Continue to work with the faith that unearned suffering is redemptive. Go back to Mississippi. Go back to Alabama. Go back to South Carolina. Go back to Georgia. Go back to Louisiana. Go back to the slums and ghettos of our northern cities. Knowing that somehow this situation can and will be changed. Let us not wallow in the valley of despair. I say to you today, my friend, so even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day, even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice, I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day, down in Alabama, with its vicious racists, with its governor having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and nullification, one day right there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted, and every hill and mountain shall be made low, the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. This is our hope. This is a faith that I go back to the South with. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. This will be the day when all of God's children will be able to sing with new meaning, "My country, 'tis of thee." Sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And if America is to be a great nation, this must become true. So let freedom ring from the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire. Let freedom ring from the mighty mountains of New York. Let freedom ring from the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania. Let freedom ring from the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado. Let freedom ring from the curvaceous slopes of California. But not only that, let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain of Tennessee. Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill of Mississippi, from every mountainside. Let freedom ring, and when this happens, and when we allow freedom ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, "Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last."
That is, of course, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. delivering his iconic speech on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial on August 28, 1963. Tomorrow, Haitian refugees in the United States. Did the Obama administration go far enough with a temporary legal status? Ted Koppel is among our guests. I'm Rebecca Roberts. This is Talk of the Nation from NPR News.